Tomorrow afternoon, the GLC's planning committee meets to consider an application to build a six-storey office block by St George's Hospital at Hyde Park Corner. The site has become the centre of a political row following the government's decision to sell it for £23,000. Its market value is around £20 million. However, under a 200-year-old agreement, the government were bound to sell back the site to its original owner at its original price when it was no longer required as a hospital. Alan Hargreaves discovered when he went to find out who owns London.
400 years ago, this London land was farms and pasturage, clustered about the old Roman walls of what is now the city. It was owned by the church, who drew immense wealth and power from their position. Had they not made one grave mistake, London might never have become the city it is today. Today, a few estates have kept vast areas of London. How? Author Michael Hansen.
The simple fact is that the families don't give their property away even to their own family. The estates are held in trust and they are enjoyed by the current holder of the title for his lifetime and then in turn passed on to his descendants.
Through careful planning, these lands are worth millions of pounds. Who are some of the landlords? Parts of Maida Vale, Edgware Road and even Swinging Chelsea are owned by the church commissioners. When Henry kicked the Pope out, he created another powerful group in its place.
The workers of the church are not exactly dependent on your pennies in their Sunday collection plate. With 300 acres, the church commissioners are one of London's largest landowners. Properties like this, Little Venice, provide the clergymen of the Church of England with two-thirds of their annual incomes.
The Church of England is rich in lands. Their annual income nowadays from London is about £20 million.
The Church, as we know it, the Church of England, has really always owned land, and in fact the oldest recorded land held in one ownership actually belongs to the Church of England. Over the years they have ploughed back their profits from property, and it is their duty to maximise their returns to pay for the upkeep of the clergy, of course.
William the Conqueror gave the royals a head start. He grabbed a third of Britain. The Crown Estate acres are worth 350 million.
Perhaps most famous of the properties on the Crown Estates are these, the Nash Terraces round Regent's Park.
Crown Estates get £15 million a year revenue from London, but the royals don't own it. They were nationalised.
Well, they're in a different category altogether, of course, because what were originally the sole preserve of the monarch are now, in fact, owned by the state in effect, because the Crown Estate, all the Crown lands, were handed over by George III to Parliament, who in return gave him back some money to live on, and that we now call the civil list. But Buckingham Palace, for example, and all the royal palaces are owned by the government, run by the Department of the Environment. All the old Crown farmlands and the Crown property in London is now run by the Crown Estate Commissioners. And the income from that is remitted to the Treasury, out of which the Queen gets a portion to run the Royal Household.
The money's come from properties all over London, even from Soho and pockets of riverside land. And to ensure there's enough to go round, the Prince of Wales has his own hereditary London land. The 45 acres on London's South Bank, administered by the Duchy of Cornwall, are worth £20 million.
The Oval cricket ground, scene of so many triumphs and defeats.
How did the Prince of Wales become a landlord in his own right in South London?
Well, just a historical accident. It was thought that the eldest son of the sovereign should have his own estate, and it has always been maintained separately. But again, it's a good example of where land's held in trust.
Possibly the choicest and some of the most valuable of London's land belongs to a huntsman's descendant, the Duke of Westminster.
The owner of this little lot, and much more of London besides, is Britain's richest man. His income's estimated at £3 a second. That's £10,800 an hour, a lot more than many Londoners earn in a year.
From Hyde Park to Chelsea Bridge Road, from Green Park to Sloane Square, it's the right address. With clever planning and rigorous tenancy agreements, the estate covers acres of very desirable property.
On the Grosvenor estate of the Duke of Westminster, for example, there are 4,500 leases. Now, that may be a lease of one whole building, it may be several tenants in one building. But if you take the properties just around this square, which were originally houses, any one of these today could sell for £1 million at least. And this is just one part of their estate. The whole of Belgravia is 200 acres. This is just a small part of it.
And would you hazard a guess at how much it's worth?
Only off the top of my head. I think that the Grosvenor estate would probably rank alongside our biggest public property company in terms of the size of its assets, which is over £1,000 million.
The Russell family, now Dukes of Bedford, are reckoned to have been one of the first great landlords.
It wasn't always gloomy and rainy here. The Bedfords got the trumps when Henry VIII was dealing out the land from the monasteries when he dissolved them. He gave them the Abbot of Westminster's kitchen garden, and it turned out to be Covent Garden.
In 1631, the fourth Earl of Bedford hired Inigo Jones to build over his Covent Garden acres. In a brilliant concept, the architect created a piazza that became a byword for London planning and a world-famous example of how a city should be developed. The estate bought and sold its lands to institutions like the British Museum. As residents moved away, commerce was allowed to move in as the age of industry engulfed London. The Bedfords' wealth and property fluctuated with each successive holder of the title.
Most of the estates have actually shrunk in size, and the Duke of Bedford is a good example because, in fact, in the 20s, between the wars, the then Duke thought that stocks and shares were a much better investment and sold off a lot of his property.
London came to us by marriage, pure and simple. A small farm, in those days considered a rather bad inheritance, as you know, has turned out slightly better than that.
What did it turn into, the small farm?
Bloomsbury. One of my ancestors very nearly lost his everything, but fortunately died when he was very young. He gambled away even two other boroughs of London and part of the East India Company and part of a major bank. But I think one's finances have fluctuated a little, not that dramatically, except, as you know, since my grandfather's death as well.
Death duties then were enormous, almost £8 million. Unless they were very clever years ago and made provision, the taxman takes a fortune from these families. To gain the maximum revenue, London's aristocratic landlords must husband their resources carefully.
Yes, the trustees of the time took the decision to sell quite a large part of our London estate, and the revenue from our London estate does contribute considerably towards the losses at Woburn.
Is it all worth it, though?
Yes, I mean, it's rather like a curate's egg in parts, and other parts infuriate one. But by and large, these houses, unlike their continental counterparts, have always been shared. And I think it's our duty today to not only share them, but try and ensure they have a future.
The Bedford's 20 London acres are now worth £15 million. All the landlords say they must make sure they maintain their property so that all of us can benefit. But can these great estates survive?
The great threat now to the great estates is that, in fact, the last Labour government introduced a new tax on discretionary trusts in 1974. And the idea is that every 10 years, the whole estate should be valued for taxation. And the estates themselves predict that after perhaps 30 years, they won't have any assets left.
Is it right that these few families, these ennobled or ancient families, should own so much of prime London land, particularly the inner London land?
Well, that's a very subjective question. If you don't believe that they should, you don't believe in it. But if I can just point out one advantage to all Londoners, these estates which they created are now still the best areas of London. They're highly prized by the people who live in them, let alone the people who own them, we've been talking about. They are now recognised by the government and designated as conservation areas. Everybody wants to preserve them as they are. And if they had just been sold off piecemeal, as other developments were, if the man had just said, here's the land, I'll sell you a plot, you build your own house, it doesn't have to look like the one next door, we would have just had a motley collection of buildings in London instead of the areas that we're now very proud of.
That report from Alan Hargreaves.